If we look at the body, we can see that it's built in hierarchical order. In the organism level is the whole human, and it has several organ systems that function together. Then higher in the hierarchy, there is the organ system level. It's a group of organs that carries out a more generalized function, like circulatory system and digestive system. Higher in the, this order, there is the organ level. In the organ level, there are two or more types of tissues that work together to complete a specific task, like the heart, the liver, the stomach, the brain. Then there is the tissue level. Tissue are a group of cells with similar functions, like muscle cells, nerve cells, microglial cells, that Mona, that Professor Sarek was talking to you about. And the higher level is the cellular level. Cells are the smallest unit of life. In this lesson, we'll talk about cells. We'll understand the basic mechanism of heredity and the basic structures. So, our human body is built up, built from 10 in the power of 13 cells. You can see here an electron microscope picture of a red blood cell. In the middle, a nerve cell. And in the right, an egg cell with a sperm. Now, about the sizes. You can see here a size bar, which means that the size of the length of the line is 10 micrometer. So just to give you a clue about the sizes of the cells, so you know that kilometer is a meter in the power of, in 10 in the power of 3. Millimeter is 10 in the power of minus 3. Micrometer, it's 10 in the power of minus 6. And nanometer is 10 in the power of, in the power of minus 9. It's really, really tiny units. Most of the creatures on Earth are built up from one cell, like bacteria. Other creatures like us are built from many cells, that every cell has different character for different function. But all of us, we begin from one cell. And all our cells are the vehicle for heredity. And now I want to talk to you about this basic element of cell. So today we'll talk about the introduction to the cell. And then we'll talk about internal organization of the cell. We'll talk about the plasma membrane, the nucleus, the endoplasmatic reticulum, and the mitochondria, which are two organelles that have an important role in neurodegeneration. So, like computers, living cells deal with the information. They should store their information and transmit their information. Our cell process this information with the DNA. The DNA is a long unbranched polymer chain that have always it's built up from a sugar with a phosphate on it and a base. So the backbone is the sugar and the phosphate, and then there are four types of bases. There is the G, the T, the A, and the C. Guanine, thymine, adenine, and cytosine. You don't have to remember, you don't have to learn it by heart, it will be on the net, and okay. Just, you have to understand the basic idea. So there is the backbone of the sugar and the phosphate, and then attached to it is a base. So every connection of the backbone of the sugar and the phosphate are linked together the, in the same way, you see? The G and the T are linked together, and then the T to the A and the A to the A, the linkage is the same with the, in the same chemical reaction. The difference is the different base that attached to it. So theoretically, in a tube, when we put a base, this backbone with the sugar and a nucleotide, any backbone can link to each other. But in the living cells, there is a constraint. The synthesis is complementary to the other strand. As you can see, there is one strand here, and the other strand is here. Always in our cells, the G is attached to a C, and the A and the T is attached to an A. Okay? So if you want to, if a cell divides, and we want to copy the DNA, this linkage between the bases breaks, and each strand is built up on the other strand, and then and it forms the double-stranded helix. Here you can see Watson and Crick, which on, they discovered this double-stranded structure of the DNA, and they won for it for a Nobel Prize. So here we can see again that there is the template DNA, and if a cell is divided and there is an okay, those connections are detached. Each template strand can build on himself a new strand. Okay, in the complementary way where A is attached to a C and the G to a C. Okay. But it's not enough to divide. You have to operate. So the main dogma, which next lesson I will show you that it's not the usual, it's the unusual, that DNA can process to RNA, and RNA can process to protein. Yeah. DNA can process to RNA, and RNA to protein.
Transcription.
Yeah, this process from DNA to RNA is transcription, and the process from RNA to protein is translation. Okay, so from one strand of DNA, many, many strands of RNA can be can transcribe. Okay. Okay. Now, the RNA stores the information for the for the protein. Protein building blocks are quite different from the DNA building blocks that we saw here, the sugar and the base. Here the building blocks are a carbon with amino group, with carboxyl group, and with side chain. This is the backbone of protein, of amino acid. There are lots of there are about 20 side chains that each one is different in his chemical and in his chemical protein properties. Ones are more basic than the others, and ones have more negative or positive charge on it. And the interaction between the side chains creates three-dimensional composition of the protein, structure of the protein.
Structure of A cell,
No, it's not
What's the A cell? I don't understand when you say A cell. What do you mean?
Do you mean the A with the T?
No. The A, T, C.
A cell is a base.
Okay, so okay. So this is just the DNA inside the cell, which stores the heredity information. It's the archive of information. It's like a library. And this is the backbone of this DNA. The DNA can transcribe to RNA, which is an intermediate form of information that we'll not talk about today, but next week we will. And from RNA is translated to protein. Protein actually is the building blocks of the cell. It will see it catalyzes all the reaction, most of the reaction in the cell. Now we are talking about the building blocks of the protein.
Okay.
Thank you for the question. As the building block of DNA are composed from phosphate, sugar, and base, the building block of protein is built from amino acids, and this is the backbone. It's carbon, amino group, carboxylic acid group, and the side chain. And each amino acid is different. Each amino acid is different from the other by the side chain, by its chemical properties. Okay? Okay. Protein are how the cell is manifest its information. Protein builds the cell. It's the cytoskeleton of the cell. Protein enhance catalytic reactions. I'll give you here an example. Here is a three-dimensional structure of protein. The chain is one amino acid attached to the other, and the three-dimensional structure is composed from the side chain interaction of one amino acid to the other. For example, a protein can hydrolyze this chain in the catalytic side, and it can break it to two chains. Okay, in the active site. The active site, the three-dimensional properties of this active site is because of the, is a result of the interaction between the side chains of the amino acids. Okay, so what is the connection between those bases, the C, T, G, A, and the amino acid? So, who knows the genetic code here? Okay. So there is a code, the genetic code, the ribosome that we'll soon talk about can read it and translate this code to amino acid. And this code is known for many years, and you can see that if the cell can read T, G, and T, it will incorporate cysteine. If it will read C, C, and T, it will read proline. If it will read T, A, and A, it will stop incorporate amino acid, and probably it will be the end of the protein, the end of the synthesis. It's like a code. As you can see, we have four bases, and there are three bases for each code, and each base can be one of four. So there are 64 options.
Combination.
Thank combinations. And as you can see, there are redundancies. So the machinery in the cell that can translate RNA to protein is the tRNA, the transfer RNA. On this is RNA, it's untranslated RNA, that on one side, it has the amino acid, the appropriate amino acid attached to it, in this case, tryptophan. And on the other hand, there is the anticodon for the RNA. For example, let's look for the tryptophan here. If there is here ACC, so I need to find the anticodon for the ACC. It's TGG on the RNA. It's the complementary to those three bases. Who wants to ask me a question?
What's in the RNA?
Yeah. Thanks. Do you want to ask him a question? Because okay. Thanks for reminding me. But in the RNA, there is no T. Instead of T, there is U, which uratel. So as you can see here, when the anticodon is attached to the codon of the mRNA, the UGG, the tRNA insert and incorporate the amino acid to the proper place. Okay, here you can see the real three-dimensional structure of the tRNA, which here it attached to the amino acid, and here it has the anticodon, the proper anticodon. Okay? Who knows other than that? The Nobel Prize winner from last...
Yeah.
She looked and crystallized and understood the mechanism of the ribosome, and now you will be able to understand what she found out. So the ribosome is a multi-structure, a huge complex of protein and RNAs. The RNA is formed inside the cell and then shifted out and outside the cell in a place called endoplasmatic reticulum. We will talk about it later. We can call it ER, endoplasmatic reticulum. There are lots of ribosomes which translate with using the tRNA, the code of the mRNA to protein.
The messenger RNA.
Yes.
The messenger RNA that goes from the cell to the ribosome.
Exactly. I don't have nothing to write with, but if there is, So in a few minutes we'll see that if this is the cell, and the nucleus of the cell is here, and the DNA here. So the DNA is processed to RNA, messenger RNA. And the messenger RNA go out from the nucleus to the endoplasmatic reticulum, which we should see later. In the endoplasmatic reticulum, there are lots of ribosomes, which enhance the translation to proteins. Okay? And this is for the first part of our talk today. So short summary. our archive of information is the DNA, which composed from backbone of sugar and phosphate. There are four bases, G, T, A, and C, in a double helix structure. To copy this DNA, the two template strands are break apart. Once this is one template strand from here, and this is one template strand from here, then the new strand is built in a complementary way of the base pairing T to A and C to G. Sorry? The bases here separate from each other, detached from each other.
Okay, but then they have new bases to...
Yeah. Okay, to manifest this information, the cells use protein. In the middle, it use in the intermediate molecules called RNA. We'll not talk about it today, but next week we'll talk about the RNA. And it translates to protein through the genetic code by tRNA in the ribosome. Okay? Okay. Now we'll talk about the internal organization of the cell. Cells are different from each other. Like nerve cells has other properties than blood cells, and muscle cells has other properties than endothelial cells, but all of them have some basic elements that are necessary for life. Now, here in this this lesson, I want to talk to you about some basic elements. There are a lot. But the basic element that I want to talk to you about are important for the neurodegenerative disease. So, what is the most important thing that you think that cell need? The most important thing for a cell? Energy, DNA. So the So the most important thing for a cell to live is to be different from its environment. And in our life, the cell membrane doing this function. The cell is surrounded by a phospholipid bilayer, which separates it from its environment. And it creates a mini environment different from the outside that can create and enhance life. This membrane is built from a phospholipid bilayer. Now I want to talk to you about a little bit about this phospholipid. It has two parts, this phospholipid. One part that is hydrophilic. Hydrophilic, it loves water. It can interact with water. And the other part is hydrophobic. Hydrophobic is afraid from water. It doesn't like to react with water. Okay, because it's a fatty acid. It's a fat. So, if there are molecules like that, that in one part likes water and in the other way part doesn't like water, when there are lots of molecules like this together, it can arrange itself or in micellas like this. Just for general knowledge, soap is built from micellas like this. Soap, sabon. it's enclosed, all the dirt inside, and it can be washed out. And the other way to be arranged in the space is here, the hydrophobic part to interact with water, the hydrophilic part to interact with the hydrophilic part of the other molecule, and then on the other side, the hydrophilic part on the other hand. Okay, like this. And actually, this is how our bilayer is created. Okay? When there is just one, when there is just one arm here, so micella will be created. And when there are two arms here, in the form of a cylinder, so bilayer will be created. Okay? And this actually separates the cell from its surrounding. Okay. Okay. But cells have to interact with its surrounding. It have to cells to sense stimuli. It have to bring in nutrients. It have to take out waste. So, in this lipid membrane that cannot interact with this surrounding, there are lots of ways to interact with, to bring and take out information. And this passage of information is brought by proteins. There are lots, many kinds of interactions that cells can do with its surrounding by protein. It can use a ion channel to bring in ions, and it can create closed and open shapes of those channels to enable and disable passage of ions in and out this the double this membrane. In addition, there are ion channels that need the interaction with the that need the input of energy to open and to close itself. And this is how the cell, which is separate from its surrounding, can interact. Okay, the second organelle that I want to talk to you about is the cell nucleus. The cell nucleus is an organelle which stores the heredity information, the DNA, inside the cell. You can see it here in dark. This is the electron microscope image. And you can see it here and here. Those are confocal microscope images. You can see that in every cell, that the percentage that the nucleotide is different from the other. Okay, so the nucleus itself is a closed organelle, also with a also with a membrane. Also, there are pores and there are channels that that controls the intake and out of the of nutrition and all kinds of things into and out of the of the nucleus. In the nucleus, so we said there is the DNA. The RNA is transcribed inside the nucleus, and the messenger RNA that translate to a protein go out here. Here, the outer part of the nucleus interacts with the endoplasmatic reticulum, which we talked about. It's also a membrane, also a fatty membrane, which the ribosomes are all over, and they are translated to protein here in the endoplasmatic reticulum. Here you can see the membrane of the nucleus. The lamina is a group of proteins that are the cytoskeleton, are the skeleton of the nucleus. Here, the two membranes of the nucleus. The pore complex that can insert or take out all kinds of protein and information from the cell out, and the ER with the ribosomes. I just want to tell you that protein has to go in the nucleus as well. Protein can copy the DNA. It's important to transcribe the DNA to RNA. There are histones that hold the whole DNA in a chromosome, in a chromosome-like structure. So also protein can go in and go out, and bases for the RNA and the DNA, okay? Okay. The endoplasmatic reticulum is this labyrinth outside the cell. I just want to tell you that also the endoplasmatic reticulum is has different shape and different size and different characteristic in lots of cells. There are cells like the mast cell of the immune system. Their job is to produce lots of antibodies. They are actually machines of antibodies. So they're part of the endoplasmatic reticulum in the whole cell is a huge part. It's like 90% of the whole cell is endoplasmatic reticulum, unlike other kinds of cells. So the endoplasmatic reticulum is an essential component for the maturation and processing of protein folding. As I told you, the protein is a chain of amino acid which should go and create and transform itself to three-dimensional structure. The structure should be uniform and the same for all protein, and the way to fold is very, very sequential and very important and very critical. We'll see in a moment how. So the endoplasmatic reticulum is composed from three parts: the rough endoplasmatic reticulum, the smooth endoplasmatic reticulum, and the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Each one has different characters and jobs and properties. The rough endoplasmatic reticulum synthesizes protein. The smooth one synthesizes lipid and steroids. And the sarcoplasmatic regulates calcium levels. Calcium levels has a major and very critical influence on the situation of and on the decision of life and death in the cell. The cells can decide to kill itself by apoptosis, and calcium level has a critical role in this decision. This is one of the reasons why the endoplasmatic is so important for degenerative diseases. In two or three lectures, you will hear Ehud Cohen. He will talk about the connection between endoplasmatic reticulum, stress, neurodegeneration. The endoplasmatic reticulum, the rough one, which is filled with ribosomes, can interact with the Golgi apparatus, which shuttle proteins to its to their appropriate places. There are proteins that have to be on the membrane, proteins that have to be on the nucleus, and in the mitochondria that we'll talk about later, and the Golgi apparatus transmit the proteins to the appropriate place. Okay, so ER stress is a stress inside the cell. When the ER senses that protein does not fold as they should have been, if they sense that there are too many proteins inside the endoplasmatic reticulum, it means that there are a lot of protein that doesn't go out to the Golgi. It's stuck, it's like pkak tnua. And it signals to the cell that there is something is wrong. And the cell should stop its translation, its RNA, and to see what happened. The ER goes much bigger to form more, to create more places for more ribosomes to come. This is an emergency for the cell. And as you will see, the ER stress is a major component in neurodegenerative disease. About the unfolded protein response and the mTOR response, you'll talk later with Ehud. So, okay, I told you about it. So, of course, you don't have to know this scheme by heart, but I put it here because I wanted to show you that in ER stress, when the cell is in emergency, it creates emergency reaction, which ends up, which can and may end up with cell death. And again, this process is crucial and very, 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 very basic in neurodegenerative diseases. As you can see, ER stress can signal by some proteins and protein-protein interactions to the mitochondria that something is wrong. And now let's talk a little bit about the mitochondria because it's also a basic element in neurodegenerative disease. So the mitochondria actually is the tachanat koach, is the power supply of the cell. In two words, it creates energy, in the chemical energy, in the form of ATP from oxygen. Using glucose. But I don't want to go deeper into it, although if you're interested, I would be happy to send you material. In addition to its major job as a chemical power supplier, mitochondria are involved in a range of other processes like signaling, cellular differentiation, cell death, control of cell cycle, and cell growth. As you can see here, the cell death, the cell signaling has major parts and components in neurodegeneration. The mitochondria also can create free radical. Free radical are species that are very dangerous to the cell. It also brings the cell into mitsuka, emergency, stress, like, and can create death. induce death. There are lots of experimental support to the involvement of mitochondria in cell death and neurodegeneration. And the interaction between the endoplasmatic reticulum and the mitochondria in calcium and the cells and the stress signaling to the cell are a major component that you will talk about a lot. Yes, I will upload it on Moodle. I don't know if you were at the beginning of our talk. Apparently, the paper that you have to work on for next week is not on Moodle as I thought. During this weekend, I will put it on the Moodle, and you will have one more week, so you don't have to do it for next week, but for 2 weeks from now, and bring it here. Yeah, questions.
Can you explain in more details how the mitochondria bring the cell to death?
I can, but I don't want to. Because in the next lessons, you professors, special scientists that work with the mitochondria will come here. But what I want to tell you that free radical production can destroy proteins and phospholipid membrane and so on, and the cell can sense it and bring itself to a mode of apoptosis. Apoptosis is a mode that the cell commit a suicide because it feels that it can that something dangerous and really really bad happening, so it kills itself for the whole tissue. And this is one mechanism. The other mechanism is the calcium signaling, also intracellular huge amount of calcium can bring the cell also to a mode of suicide, of apoptosis, which is very common in neurodegeneration. Calcium is good. It's not the calcium that you eat. The calcium that you eat, it has nothing to the, as far as I know, has nothing to the intracellular calcium metabolism. תאכל calcium, נראה לי. More? So that's it for today. Thank you. Next week, we'll talk about the nervous cell, about how they sense and transmit information by chemical and electrical combined reaction. And we'll talk about molecular biology. We'll go to the why are you smiling? How the RNA process, how the cell create RNA from DNA, this will be the next one. So that's it.